Welcome our viewers, how are you? Today we are going to be looking at a very interesting topic, that is work politics and how this affects young people or the youth. And so today we are joined by our one and only Hilda Maloa, the CEO of Resume Revamp. And she's also a master student at Daystar University. So welcome, Hilda Maloa.
Thank you very much for this opportunity, Joy, and it's really a privilege to be here. And also as a youth, to speak about work politics is quite an interesting, and I really appreciate this opportunity.
Welcome, welcome. So basically, what do you understand when you hear the word work politics? What is your view on what work politics really is?
Okay, work politics, or probably as other people probably will refer to as organizational politics, is basically how human beings or how we interact in our organizations, in our workplaces. However, in this case, the power and authority aspect comes in. Mm-hmm. So it's just how we interact, and with power and authority, how someone who has a specific power or a specific authority will interact with that person who doesn't have it, or how they also interact amongst themselves.
Mm-hmm. Actually, basically how they use the power, that's what you mean,
yes,
right?
Especially in the interactions.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so work politics is probably maybe on the negative, because we have positive work politics and negative work politics.
I think I'll say we have both positive and negative work politics, depending on how this person on power and authority is using their is using this power and authority that they have, how they're using what they have. So it can either be positive or negative, depending on how you want to make it to spearhead it.
Great. So there are people who've used their positions of leadership negatively, or maybe just to incite others against someone at the workplaces, and sometimes this is unfair. And so you find that that person has probably lost their jobs unfairly, just because someone decided to, you know, do what they call the witch hunting and all that. So what would you say about that, you know, bullying at work?
So, you see, when you talk about organizational politics or work politics, it takes different forms. And I can comfortably mention at least six of them. So one, we have individuals within the organization that are, I'll use the word gossip hound. So when you have a gossip hound, I think each and every organization have these different kind of characters. A gossip hound is someone who always within the organization knows what is going on, and they are always ready to share the information with anyone. So all you need to do is to ask, what did such and such a person do? And they have the information, they'll give you all the details that is required. So that is how a gossip hound works. And then we have this kind of people who are credit thief. A credit thief will just do anything possible to take the credit from the person who did the job. So they always try to go ahead of you. Like, they'll look at it, okay, he has done this job, but such an element is missing. So they decide, let me go ahead of her or ahead of him and add that element that is missing. And in that way, they've gotten the credit that they needed. And then we also have this group who are saboteurs. They just don't want things to go well for other people. Like, they are always ready to pick on you. I think the right word you're using is bullying. They just want to make sure your project doesn't go well. However, on their side, they do everything possible to make sure things within them or what they're supposed to do goes perfectly well. And then, aside from that, I can also say we have this kind of people who are flatterers. So a flatterer will always give you compliments. Hi Hilda, you look very good. So the difference is, you don't know if this is a genuine comment. Now that's where the challenge comes in. Is this a genuine comment, or are you saying it for me to impress me, or are you saying it to get favors from me? So that aspect really comes in. So you need to know, as a person in every organization, you need to know, who am I, who is this person I'm dealing with? Is he a flatterer? Is he a credit thief? Is he a saboteur? So you need to learn to get to know all these kind of people.
Wow, that is quite intense. I don't know, I think I've interacted with flatterers, you know, someone who would compliment you, but then again, they are doing it for their own, they have their own agenda, you know, out of malice. They are not doing it because they want they feel that you're actually very good at your work. They're not doing it to compliment you, but they're doing it because probably they need some information so that they can now use that information against you.
Yeah.
I've experienced that at work, and that is really, really sad. Yeah. Now, just coming back to our topic and how this affects the youth, do you think that most young people are shying away from applying for these jobs because they feel that they will not be appreciated at work, and they feel that they will not fit in the working environment because probably maybe the people who've been there for the longest time will not give them that
opportunity,
you know?
Mm-hmm. Okay, there's that aspect of people shying away to apply for specific jobs because they feel like there's someone already for the job.
Mm.
You see, with organizational politics, you'll find with the power and authority coming in it, the jobs will have, people will apply, but they're probably for formality. Mm. Already there's someone doing the job. So with you, you're applying it for formality. So with that aspect, and then with human interactions, human beings are social beings. So you may interact with someone and tells you, that job, such and such a person is doing it. So in your mind, it's like, this job was just advertised the other day. Mm. I applied for it. Mm. And then I'm being told already someone is
has already been paid.
Yeah,
that is a sad reality.
So it makes someone feels their frustration comes in.
Mm.
And if you don't have the strength or if you're not strong enough, many time people become, they stop applying for these jobs.
Mm.
They now decide, let me just do whatever I can.
Let me just hustle, let me just commit crimes. You know, let me just steal from people.
Yeah.
Let me sleep around to get favors because really, there are no jobs and the job market is quite unfair, you know?
So
wow.
Such things can make someone decide they shy away from applying for the jobs.
And sorry to cut you short, but in this line, I'm actually thinking about interns at the workplaces, and what they would go through. Sometimes they're given so much work by whoever you're supposed to be helping or whoever you're working with, you get. So this in turn will find it very difficult dealing with such people. And so what happens if once they are done with their internship, they don't even want to apply for a job in that place? And if they do not do your job, you know, whoever is taking advantage of them, what happens is, I think, like you're saying, they will be discriminated, they will be fired from the job because
frustrations.
They will be frustrated.
You see, I think that is one group that people tend to forget. Those university students who are just coming for internship, or that university student who is coming for attachment. You see, this person, this is their first work experience. So they're there for 3 months, and somehow they're seeing what is happening. It's not like they're not seeing. It's the fact that they don't have a voice or they can't talk it out, it doesn't mean they're not seeing what is happening. So many a time you'll find them, I think that is what even these institutions with negative reputation face, because this intern was there for 3 months, was there for 6 months. You didn't treat them right. You're supposed to teach them how to do the job, not give them the job to do. Many time you'll find that they have been given the job to do. How am I supposed to do work that I don't know how it's done? You see, so you'll find that in such situations they become frustrated, they get tired, and at times they just feel like, I can't wait to be done. You see, there's that joy when it's your first job, it's your first attachment, you're so excited about it. Then you go find the environment so toxic, everybody knows who and who knows who. Or you come to an environment whereby, probably let's say we have two or three interns, and then looking at it, you find that she is a relative to her. Her is a relative to him. So in the long run, even if you like the place, you'll go back there knowing that I can't get a job in this place because it's a matter of whom do you know?
Who do you know? My goodness. So your relations. I'm wondering what happened to the content of our character, you know? The fact that I have trained for this job and I know that I'm well skilled for this job. Do I still have to go and please you know I've ever faced such, the reason why I'm talking about I've ever faced such, and again, even for young girls or young women in the workplaces who are facing what you'd call sexual harassment, the fact that maybe your boss or whoever you consider to be your senior is making some sexual advancements and you're not able or you don't want to actually compromise, mm-hmm. So I'm thinking of such a girl or such a woman facing that. What would you advise them,
Okay, so for me, one thing I've come to learn in the course of my experience, mm-hmm. and in the course of my working environment is that the first thing you need to do in overcoming these work politics, organizational politics, the he or she there, mm-hmm. is first of all making as many friends as possible, mm-hmm. within the place. Maloa or Hilda may not like you, but as long as you have other friends who will advise you on what to do. Because I might be in a situation I don't know how to go about it. Mm-hmm. Hilda, who is supposed to be my supervisor, is not helping me out.
Yeah.
But I can have Joy, who happens to be probably a colleague to Hilda or assistant to Hilda. Joy will help me out as an intern. So that is one aspect I'd like to advise all the people who are doing the internship, mm-hmm. and all those who are going for the attachment.
Mm-hmm.
The first thing you need to know is make as many friends as possible. Mm. And as I said earlier on, human beings are social beings.
So yeah.
Socialize within the organization, interact with people, know the organizational culture. The minute you know how this organization has been carrying out itself,
mm-hmm.
its culture, how things are done,
mm.
you're able to at least move forward easily,
mm.
as compared to just being green and not knowing what to do.
Mm.
So my first advice is to make as many friends as possible.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Secondly, I would advise these people facing issues with organizational politics and issues with and the interns, so I'll advise them to another thing is to do is to excel at your work.
Mm.
The minute you're able to do each and everything well and appropriately,
mm-hmm.
I was told I'm not supposed to sit in this place or when I'm doing this specific design,
mm-hmm.
these are the corporate colors,
mm-hmm.
this is what I'm supposed to do.
Mm.
Implement what you've been told and make sure you just excel in your work.
Mm-hmm.
The minute you are able to see what you've done, because I am sure each and every organization somehow have the job evaluation timings that they do.
Mm.
So that when you are evaluated and someone looks at what you've done, they surely see this Hilda or this Joy has delivered their work.
Mm-hmm.
So the minute you've delivered your work,
mm-hmm.
despite the challenges that you've been facing
mm-hmm.
all through,
mm-hmm.
and that situation,
mm-hmm.
one cannot really pin you down.
Mm. So you're saying be indispensable. Although that is something we definitely have to talk about later, because someone can be very, very good at their job, but the fact that they are not compromising or doing what they are supposed to do according to that particular, the culture of that particular organization,
mm-hmm.
they find themselves just getting fired or getting sacked, and so, which is very, very unfair. So just to think about, I was thinking about someone's life purpose and how that can be affected by a toxic working environment, you would be very passionate about media, but if you're working in a certain media house and there's all this work politics and people may be picking up on you, you might not really achieve your life purpose, which is now your passion. And the fact that now we would also talk about someone stepping down, because if I find myself in such a situation, I would rather just step down and ask God to help me out, or just probably maybe just become an entrepreneur in my own light, because I don't want to compromise. So I'm just thinking about someone's life purpose and how that can be affected, negatively affected by this toxic working environment.
Okay, what I'll say in regards to that, there's something we need to know, and I'll use the late Kenny Rogers song, mm-hmm. The Gambler.
Mm.
So he says that every gambler knows the time to quit,
mm-hmm.
and the time how you're going to survive all through.
Wololo, Kenny Rogers. Okay.
So Kenny Rogers talks about the gambler.
Mm-hmm.
Every gambler knows the time to quit,
mm-hmm.
and the time to continue gambling.
Mm-hmm.
So as a person, mm-hmm. when you see that something is really affecting your life, you see, when the working environment becomes so toxic, you might even end up bringing the toxicity from work to home.
Yeah.
And it may affect your children and your family, that aside.
Mm.
But you need to know that this is the much I can deal with.
Mm. And this is what I can't take.
You need to know, this is my limit.
Mm.
At time, it's good to speak it out because you can just tell someone, Hilda, you're doing 1, 2, 3, and I don't like it. At the same time, I also probably would like to say that organizations should also know that these characters, when you're trying to do the personality test,
yes,
I think it's something I would advise organizations to do, personality test, so that an employer and an employer, or a supervisor and a supervisee do not clash. That way your personalities are somehow similar and it's easier to work. So probably one thing I would say is that you should just know this is my limit and this is the match I can take.
Yes.
When the worst come to the worst. And something I've also come to learn is to always have a fallback plan. And in as much as probably you might be somewhere working, one thing I'll probably challenge everyone or every youth out there, continuous job application. And for me, one thing I can say is that there's no single day that goes without me doing a job application. So that by the time probably that toxicity become too much, you can easily call it quit and move to another place.
Wow, you know, I never thought about it like that. Always have a fallback plan. Keep applying for jobs, because you never know the day that you just feel you can't take it anymore. You need to have a fallback plan. Don't get comfortable. That's exactly what you're saying. Don't get comfortable, because you never know when someone decides to pick on you, and then you just find yourself with a termination letter. There's a teacher friend of mine who was working in a certain school, and he had worked there for around 17 years. And I can tell you, on one particular Wednesday morning, and he was coming very early to class to do remedial classes, and what he told me is that the secretary just came towards him and told him, Mr. So-and-so, there's a letter here for you. And he's like, oh, okay, fine, just bring it. He's like, I'll read it later because I'm busy. I have to go to class. And she's like, and they're like, the secretary told him, no. Please read it here. And he's like, okay, fine. Then he opens, and there was a, he was terminated from work. And by the way, that emanated from work politics. Yes, he had disciplined a student. And according to this school, maybe the students are not supposed to be disciplined or harshly treated, but then again it emanated from some work politics where someone didn't want the very best for him. And I'm telling you, that is what happened with this guy. 17 years of employment in this school and all the dedication, and it all goes to the drains. You can imagine what that can do to that kind of a person, and how that damages even their self-esteem, you know, and their livelihood at large.
And even some people, what I'll say, if they're not strong enough, some people go into stress and depression. And within no time, you may find someone commits a suicide. We're always talking about suicide, but we forget to know that some of these issues with suicidal minds, they emanate from work. Someone will probably casually see it in a work environment. Nitaenda nikuache kazi. You see, you may take it casual, but look at it. Why would someone just make such a statement? Yet this is their main source of livelihood. So I think it's very much important that organizations are able to adapt, do the personality test, and able to communicate with the employer and employee, the relations to be made at least better off.
Wow, this is quite intense. I'm thinking about a young person from college who's just joined a certain organization, and what they go find there, you know, with this maybe older people. We don't want to say that all the older guys working in organizations are bad, but the fact that they would go to such an environment and they find no one really wants to assist you, no one wants to show you this is the way we do this, no one wants to give you guidelines. And so what that person does when they get frustrated, they will just call it quits. You find them, like you're saying, having committed suicide in their homes. You know, you find them maybe engaging in crimes or all these very bad activities, because how are they going to survive, you know? And by the way, like, COVID has really taught us so many things, but apparently there are so many people who've committed suicide because of COVID, because they probably do not have jobs. So I'm also thinking about, just like we're talking about life purpose, I'm thinking about allowing work to define you. You know, who defines you? Is it your job that defines you?
One thing you know is, or I believe in, is as a person, you should never allow your work to define who you are. You're the one to define the kind of work you're doing. In the sense that my lower helder, I'm a person, my personality as an individual, I'm quite strict when it comes to my work environment. Mm-hmm. I know today I'm supposed to produce a newsletter by the end of this month or by the end of this quarter. Mm-hmm. So I'm supposed to plan for it. Mm-hmm. Let us live in that environment where you don't have to take that work home. Mm-hmm. The minute you take that work back home or outside the working environment, it means that that work is everything for you. You need to budget within your time. Know that from 8 to 5 I'm at work, I'll do everything pertaining to work. But after 5 is no. Because the minute you start bringing work home, you find that your life will be revolving around work, work, work. So there's nothing else that you can do apart from work. Like, all that excites you is work. I'm not saying that having excitement from your work is nothing, is bad, because some of us work because we are passionate about what we are working on. It drives us. So it's good when you do jobs that you are quite passionate about. It's really important. That is something I'll advocate for you to be passionate about your job.
But don't allow it to define you. That's what you're clear about.
Yeah.
Ah, very well, very well. You know, I know you would also give your personal experiences of work politics, but I've ever gone through such a situation where something didn't really go very well at work because probably I was very new in that working environment. And so I was very angry with this colleague, you know, not knowing very well that maybe there is what I was supposed to do and this is how he or she deals with maybe such an occurrence, you know. So what happened, I went and confided in someone else who's also a colleague, you know, and just telling them, you know, this is what happened and this is what this is how this person treated me, and so I'm really feeling so low, so I can't even go for my next session, I can't work. And so I didn't know that this person, as much as they were really trying to be nice and telling me, oh, you know what, we are gonna help you out, don't worry, you can probably maybe just report it, you know, if that person is treating you like this, you know. And I was like, oh, this person really cares for me. They were even calling me, you know, at home in the evening and tell, oh, how are you, how are you faring, how did you deal with that issue. But my friend, later on I came to realize that she or he was not a very good colleague, because she was using that against me plus more, because I had even gone ahead and tried to share my personal life with them, you know, and my challenges with them. But then they had actually gone ahead and shared that information with other people, other colleagues.
That, I'll say, will bring me back to what we had earlier on talked about. I said we have different kind of people in an organization.
Yes.
There's a flatterer. Would come, give you compliments, talk to you nicely, so that you may think, I have good motive for you, or I'm really caring about you. The challenge with these people, probably I'll say they are the worst, in the sense that you really don't know what they have for you.
Yeah.
Yeah. As compared to someone, for instance, let me say a credit thief. A credit thief will always look for an opportunity to take it from you. And we all know these people. At least somehow you know them.
Wow.
And it also bring me to something that I talked to you earlier on. I'd said about organizational culture. You see, you didn't know how this person handles themselves or how things work out.
Yeah.
So probably I'll advocate for people to be patient. When you go to an organization, take a month or two to learn how things are going on, what this person deals with, what are their responsibilities. Because the work politics also emanate from when you start to clash in terms of responsibilities. I am doing what Jay is supposed to do. I'm not learning the boundaries. So someone will feel like you're overstepping, or probably you want to take my job from me. So it's very much important, and I would advocate for everybody. Whenever you go to an organization, first of all, you need to learn the organizational culture. Give yourself a period of a month or two to learn how things are done around. Then within that, you'll be able to at least overcome some of these challenges.
Wow, wow. Learning about the culture of a certain organization. Wow, I have to definitely take that in, you know, although sometimes you don't really have the time to learn, because you just find yourself in the deep end and you've got to start functioning. Well, great. I was thinking about reading, because you know, now I found myself in a situation where, who are you going to share what you're going through with? So I decided to read. Like, I love to read a lot. So I decided to read. And someone shared a book with me. Is it the 48 Laws of Power? You know? Mm-hmm. and you know, there's that favorite phrase there. Do not outshine the master. You know, so sometimes you find yourself in situations where you're dealing with a certain senior, and since you're very good at your job, if they feel that you're a threat, they will make it very difficult for you, you know.
Okay, that is something I'll pick up and say. Mm-hmm. It's also a challenge that personally I have faced. Mm-hmm. So one thing I've learned to do, or how to overcome such an issue, is see, there's that aspect to give them space. We are colleagues, so you just make it look like outside work environment, nothing more. That is how I was able to deal with my situation. However, when you're dealing with such kind of people, especially if the person is your senior, I've written this journal, or I've written something, or I've done this specific of work, I'll probably just advise you to confirm with them. Tell them, hi Joy, I have done such and such a job. I've shared it on your email. Kindly check. You see, the minute you tell them to kindly check, yes, you know you've done everything perfectly well. So they'll feel like you've recognized them. So the best way to deal with such kind of people, you just do your part and just alert them like, hey, I've done 1, 2, 3. What do you think about it? They may probably just had the same thing in mind or had something better or they may not respond, but at least the fact that you've acknowledged them, they feel like, okay, this person knows I exist. So I would advise someone facing such a situation to just pass through by. Just tell them, hi, Hilda, I've done such and such a job. I've dropped it on your email. Kindly check it out before publishing or before me sending it out. So in that situation, they'll normally feel like, okay, they've acknowledged me. Most of the time we find that such people only face a challenge with being acknowledged. The people who love to be acknowledged that I have done it. Or they want to know, people to know that you're under me.
I think everyone wants to be acknowledged, actually.
Yes.
And appreciated at work.
Yeah, you'd like to be acknowledged. But the challenge in this case, you see, there are people who feel threatened. And it comes from different perspectives. It can be, I can threaten in terms of my work, in terms of my aggressiveness and willingness to go forward. So in such situations, that I was saying, especially in work environment, you just, you don't like really per se acknowledge like you've done the job. No. You just send them, like, for instance, if it's an article, like a writer and an editor, let's use that situation, and you find that the editor is really hard on the writer, and it's not like the writer is not doing a good job, he or she is doing good at their job and they're doing well. So in as much as, yes, as a writer, maybe you are allowed to publish, you can just pass it by him. You just tell him, hi, I've sent such an email to you, and you kindly confirm. They may not even go through it. They'll just confirm.
Because so even the language here comes to play, the kind of language and tone that you use.
Exactly.
Great. That takes us to actually your advice to employers, you know. Your advice to employers, you know, how do they ensure that they do not treat people unfairly at the workplace, you know, given that they would be listening to so much. What do you think they should do, employers?
For my advice to employers out there is that carry out a personality test. That is something I'll really advocate for. You need to do a personality test when you're employing your people. For instance, Joy and Hilda here, Joy is the writer, or Joy is the editor, let's put it that way. And Hilda is applying to be a writer in this media house. So in that case, you know the personality of Joy, you know who Joy is, you know how she works. So in that case, when you are applying for this, for when you're recruiting for this writer, let's have a personality test being done. Already you know the qualities of Joy, so just do a simple personality test. That way you're able to match each and every person. Not me, it may not be perfect, but at least it's better off. Another thing I'd like to say is that learn your employees, because you're working with different people. Different people have different challenges back home or back from where they come from. So you need to learn these employees, how they're doing their work. And trust me, you, when you're able to freely interact with the employees, learn about them, and even communicate the culture that you want. You see, organizational culture is formed from the organization itself, not from the employees. Communicate to me that in this organization, when we're having a birthday or it's somebody's birthday, we contribute 1,000 shillings for this person's cake and we celebrate it together. The last Friday of the week or the last Friday of the month, we are celebrating all the birthdays. You see, that's something that is going to make the work environment a bit friendly. And you'll find like everyone will be longing to come to work.
Yeah. Just to cut you short, I was thinking about hearsay. Maybe they should not, employers should not depend on hearsay, what they hear about Hilda, before they actually write your termination letter. Yes. What do you think they should do?
Okay, this is something that I had talked about in organization, we having gossip horns. So these are people who already know what is happening. And there's always a way, you might be at the top, but there's always a way you can disguise and interact with these employees. And when you come down here, you can actually learn what is happening. So I think it's very much important for them to give time before deciding that this person should go home.
So don't depend on hearsay. That's what you're telling the employers, and maybe what you're telling your fellow young people, you know, in the workplaces. You've told them to know how to deal with different characters at work, identify their flatterers and the what did you call them? Flatterers,
the we have the saboteurs, the we have the credit thief.
So what
I'll say to probably fellow young people or someone, an intern somewhere, someone doing the attachment is that it's never easy. That's the reality. It's never easy. But the most important thing is, what are you doing as a person to make it easy?
Thank you very much.
So it's very much important that they keep on fighting, they keep on pushing on. And when I talk about fighting, it's not like physical fighting or so. It's based on what I told you. Do your work well. People will acknowledge you. Organizations have rewards that they probably give to a good employee or something. In as much as considering it at one point, it can be a source of work politics, but the minute you're able to just deliver your work, you come in the morning, you do what brought you there, but you simply follow the simple rules and everything there. Make friends,
everything will work out.
It will be easy.
If it doesn't work out, please just quit, you know. I mean, just quit, don't compromise. That's your advice to employers, and I would also maybe want to say it's good for employers to give chances to young people. Let's give them a chance, let's give them a voice.
It's very much important, because you find at times people feel threatened. You'll go to an organization, you're just a simple young lady, you've gone there to do your work, but the fact that you're a lady is also a challenge to some people. We have male chauvinists still there.
Male chauvinists in this
time and era, someone is refusing to give you an acknowledgement or an opportunity simply because you're a woman,
or a recommendation or a promotion.
Exactly.
Simply because you're a woman.
So we just like to tell them there that we're not here to take your job.
Yes.
Especially those interns and the attachments or someone doing the first job. We're not here to take your jobs.
We are here to grow.
Yeah. And some of us here just want to learn. You see, personally, when in my profession, I didn't plan to be where I am now. But the fact that I am willing to learn.
Yes.
You correct me, I will listen. It's not that I want to take your place or I'm fighting for your position. No. I just want to learn and get more opportunities.
Yeah, I'm thinking about that, Hilda. And just as we come to a close, people forget that you have children, and you would not want them to be treated in a certain way when they go looking for those jobs. So ensure that you treat those interns or young people fairly. Teach them, show them the way. I mean, we are all not going to live forever, you know?
Yeah.
So give them a chance, give them a chance. I encourage them, teach them. You know, they're not there to threaten your job. And so I think that's just interesting. I just thought about someone who said that if it doesn't make me happy, and it doesn't make me better, and it doesn't make me money, I don't make time for it. You know? You know, by the way, just... to think about that, if it doesn't make me better,
it doesn't make you money.
It doesn't make me money, it doesn't make me happy. I don't make time for it. So I would dwell more on, since it's about life purpose, if it should make you better, it should make you happy.
Yeah.
Money, really, you can make it elsewhere, you know?
And for me, what I'll say in regards to that, I once had this saying that you make the money, you don't let the money make you.
Ah, yay. You make the money should not make you. Ah, I love that.
Wow. The essence is that when you're trying, you're the one who decide. You can decide to go and prostitute and you'll make the money. But when the money makes you, is that the money decides what you're doing.
The money defines you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But in this case, I'm telling you, you're the one who is going to make that money. Mm-hmm. You're going to look for it. So you don't let the money define who you are. In as much as there's a time, there's toxicity, there's so much going in the work environment, you don't have a peace of mind. And you're there because of the money. My friend, you'll collapse today.
Yes.
You'll die. But the organization will still be there.
They'll get someone else to do your job.
Exactly. So just know that this is my limit. So my advice probably to everyone out there, keep on pushing, keep on pressing. And as somebody once said that every artist was once an amateur. Just like every artist was an amateur. Every intern, everyone there, every CEO was once an intern somewhere. Everyone, especially if you go to the Kenyan system of education, you are once an intern, you are once an attachee. You didn't wake up and become the CEO. You didn't wake up and become the managing director. So just know that everyone was once an amateur. All that matters is how you're willing to grow and your attitude. And all in all, I'll tell them to keep on pressing, keep on pushing.
No, you have to repeat that, because you have to repeat the money part. And again about pressing on, because I just remembered something. A certain organization I also worked in, and there were some new employees and interns who came in, and there is this person who's been in that organization for the longest time, and you know what they said? Oh, this organization or institution, which I don't want to mention, this organization has employed people from the ghetto. Can you imagine? That's an older person behaving or speaking like that instead of showing these people the way. These interns probably maybe don't have the car that you're driving, because they've just started working. They can't dress the way you're dressing because they just started working. But is it ethical to really speak like that?
For me, in such a situation, one thing I'll say, these are the people who feel threatened. They feel like you've come to take the job. And when someone speaks like that, is actually they fear you, the impact you'll have. And then I also like to say, you see, there's a Swahili saying that goes by, you're passing it to the coming generation. I think it's saying people understand that these interns, these attaches are not there to take your job. They're just here to learn.
And the minute you say, they're not there to outshine you.
Help them around. If you can't help them, then at least make the working environment conducive for them.
Because they say what goes around
comes back around. Yeah. And then it's not like, you have kids, you have friends, you have family who are also there. People come from different backgrounds. So I think I'll just like to tell, like, someone saying that is so painful, especially if you're an emotional person like me. Probably I think I'll cry, I'll break down in such situation. And then stop feeling threatened. We're just here to work. By the end of the day, I'll go to my mother's house or I'll go to my house. I'm just an intern learning.
Let's make the world a better place for everybody.
Exactly. Because you'll find that someone talking like this, you'll find that they've been there for 17 years, but they started as probably an intern.
And the only way they survive there is through frustrating other people.
And bullying other people. So probably it's same for the employer, employees. Let's just make the world a better place for everyone and create a good environment.
So parting short, we've said dealing with toxicity at work, read widely, identify the organizational culture, and you've also told us to
make as many friends as possible.
And also become indispensable. But if you can't do anything about that particular situation, then just quit, which I know you don't want to agree to.
I have said this, and I've used Kenny Rogers.
Yes.
You need to know the time. And one thing I know is that for me, it has really worked for me. Many a times when I feel like this environment is becoming toxic and I can't take it anymore, that month, trust me, you personally, I'll make sure every single day I apply for a job. And by the end of that month, you always get something. And I believe that God cannot see your hard work and fail to bless you.
Yeah, true. So nice.
I'll tell you, if you feel like this one is becoming too much, you, we need you. We need you as a person in this life.
Yeah.
We need your sanity. Your family needs you.
Your job doesn't define you.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you, our viewers. That was quite an interesting session. And I think we definitely will need a work politics part two video.
Yeah.
Because honestly, I'm sure people are going through difficult situations at the workplaces, and if you would like to just share that, you can send or comment down here so that we get to see what exactly you're going through, and we also get to encourage each other, you know. Who knows? So thank you so much, Hilda Maloa.
Thank you.
We look forward to meeting you next for a work politics session too.
Thank you.
Where we'll also maybe bring another guest so that we can all share and get to see how we deal with work politics, and also just how to empower ourselves as young people. So guys, thank you very much for watching. We look forward to hosting you for the work politics part two. And so guys, if you like this content, you might want to subscribe, so just press the subscription button down there, and yeah, we look forward to interacting more with you.